Hello.
Great to see you.
You
Thank
too.
Thank you for doing this. For those of you who don't know, Adam's from San Diego and just flew into Helsinki, so he's still acclimating.
Staying awake.
Staying awake. So I'm Seth. I'm one of the partners at ICONIQ. ICONIQ is a global investment platform. We look to partner with founders from the early signs of product market fit all the way through the public markets. And have been fortunate to be a lead partner to some of the most impactful technology companies of the last decade, like Adyen, Datadog, Snowflake, GitLab, Volt here in Finland, and of course, Drata. I'm really glad that Adam agreed to do this, as he's someone that we've really admired for a long time, not only because of what he's built at Drata, but as a second-time founder, he's just been incredibly thoughtful about that journey, so I know we'll learn a lot from him. So Adam, I'll hand it to you to introduce yourself and tell us a little bit more about what Drata does.
Sure. No, thank you for having me, and it's great to be here. It's my first time in Helsinki, first time at Slush. I'm based in San Diego. I'm one of the co-founders and CEO at Drata. I fully appreciate now why it's called Slush. Almost slipped coming in. But no, it's just fantastic. Great to be here. Happy to share more about Drata. Drata is a trust management platform. We have a suite of products that sit on top of that platform. I think we're most known still at this point for our first product that we launched, which is the compliance automation product, where we help thousands of companies, thousands of startups kind of stand up and maintain their security and compliance posture, help them comply with frameworks like ISO 27001, GDPR, SOC 2, everyone's favorite acronyms. We also have other products like our risk management products for internal risk management, vendor risk management, and then a security assurance product. So our customers can actually prove that security and compliance posture during audits and during security reviews when they're selling to the enterprise.
That's great. And Adam is unfailingly humble. And so I'll add that one of the unusual things about Drata is that within its first year of going live, it was just incredibly widely and rapidly adopted. I think they mentioned that they reached 5,500 customers in just a couple years. It's certainly become a de facto tool for any software company to buy when they're getting started. I'm sure many of you in the room are already Drata customers. So let's dive in. The topic today is around trust. It's such a critical element for any company, especially one that is in compliance automation and trust management. So I thought we could start with what trust means to you at Drata and how it's become a real cornerstone to your success thus far.
Yeah, I think we were joking backstage. I think we're going to set the world record for how many times we can say the word trust in the next 20 minutes. Trust is everything to us. Trust is the ultimate business enabler. We're in the business of trust. Our customers come to us because they're selling their product in the market. The market is telling them, in order to do business with us, we need to trust that you're going to do the right things with our data. We help companies prove just that they're going to do the right by their customers' data. In that regard, it's again, I think trust is just the ultimate business enabler. I think any relationship, whether it's personal or professional business relationship, for it to have a chance to be successful, it has to be built on trust. And it's a special thing to build a company with a mission of helping build trust across the cloud. And really, our vision is to be that trust layer between our customers and all those they do business with. One of the things we did early on that helped us a lot, actually, in earning trust ourselves was use our own product, drink our own champagne, as they say.
Yep.
And that actually helped us do two things. One, it helped us prove the product works. We efficiently got to a place where we were able to earn trust by being secure and compliant from early on. And then prove also by doing that we could actually accelerate growth, unlock business, again, as the ultimate business enabler. And so we were able to do both those things just by using our own product.
Yeah. No, I love that. And I think one of the other things that I find that's so unique about Drata is the culture that you've built. It's certainly one that we deeply admire and talk to a lot of our other portfolio companies as something that's best in class. Trust is clearly a core cultural tenet of that, as we just talked about. One of the others that I'm particularly impressed by is to be a driver, not a passenger, and sort of it's very empowering and speaks to the trust that you have in your team. So maybe talk a little bit about that side of trust and how you've built such a strong culture at Drata.
Yeah, we are far from perfect. I should also say that 1,000 times in the next 20 minutes. But one of the things that we did, just coming off of our last startup and applying some of the lessons learned, was be really deliberate about culture. And that meant defining it from day one. We have our core values, trust being the one that sits above all the others. I'm a big fan of the Frank Slootman philosophy of having values that are specific to your mission. Right? Every company has culture, every company has core values, but choosing the values that actually help you execute on your specific mission, I think that's really important. And again, something we did from the beginning. The Drata rules that we now use came later, just again, by learning a lot as we went and by not being perfect. It's one thing to have our values well-defined, build it into our processes of how we hire, onboard, train, performance manage, pretty much every element of the business. It's another to actually model those values into the behavior, right? If your culture is your values plus your behavior, there was a little too much ambiguity still left on the table. And so the rules, as we called them, were really to help kind of strip away any remaining ambiguity in those values.
Hang on.
And so one of our rules, be a driver, not a passenger. We have another rule that says, it's okay to be wrong. It's better to be wrong than not know if you're right, which is another way of saying you can't just play it safe by sitting on the sideline. You have to jump in and have an opinion and be willing to be wrong, have the humility to admit when you're wrong and learn. And a lot of people don't kind of translate that back to trust, but I think that only happens in a high trust environment. So it was just another way of making our behavior, the expected behavior, a lot more tangible than just these values. And it's served us well.
That's great. For startups, gaining trust in the beginning with your customers is a real challenge. Maybe share a few anecdotes or, the early days of Drata and how you were able to create that trust with your customers and any pivotal moments that, provided unlock along that dimension.
Yeah. I guess we experienced it twice now as a second-time founder. In our prior life, we sold, it was an education space. We sold software into universities. I always remember those first handful of university customers were the absolute hardest. Yeah. Fortunately for us, nobody wanted to be the first, but then nobody wanted to be the last. So there was a nice snowball effect that kind of happened there. And similarly with Drata, in the early days, right? We launched in January of 2021. So it's been a little over 3.5 years. And like I said earlier, it was very important for us to be customer zero. Like we had to be, one, SOC 2 compliant. We had to use our own product before anybody else did. That was really, really important to us. We didn't know at the time that'd be a competitive differentiator. That's not why we did it, but go figure. And so we kind of held the curtain closed. We had these early amazing design partner customers that were in need of what we were building. We wanted their feedback. We couldn't wait to get them in, but we torturously held the curtain closed. We're behind the curtain using our own product to get our own SOC 2 report in hand. And I think it helped, actually went a long way. I mean, those customers were a little frustrated at first because they couldn't get in, but they appreciated that we weren't going to compromise on our core values, trust being at the center of it all. And that was kind of the first of many opportunities where it's, you can easily kind of compromise on some of those things for short-term gain, and we weren't going to do it. So helped us earn the trust of those earliest customers who ultimately became giant kind of evangelists of what we were doing, and not just how well the product worked, but us and the culture that we were establishing and the fact that we were going to earn trust by proving we deserved it, living our values from day one.
Yep. And you're kind of touching on this, but as you've scaled incredibly quickly from there, what are some of the processes or structures that you put in place to ensure that you're able to maintain that trust as you, scale at such hyper-growth speed?
Again, far from perfect. we've grown very, very quickly. In our prior lives at that edtech company, we always wondered what it would be like or feel like to be kind of on the other end of the spectrum, hyper-growth. And it's definitely been a hyper-growth story, and it's all the things we imagined and then some. It's amazing, it's exhilarating, and one thing it's not is comfortable.
Yeah.
Growth is change, so hyper-growth is just constant change. The goalposts are constantly moving, and that's a good thing. It's a good problem to have, as they say. And again, I think we're very far from perfect, but one thing that's served us well is by being so deliberate about these values and about culture, literally from the very beginning, from day one, it's helped kind of ingrain it into the DNA of the company. And so that makes it easier. It's not easy, but easier to maintain, even through hyper growth, because so many decisions that we make are rooted in those core values, and in trust being one of them. And there's examples of from, you know, again, how we recruit talent, how we onboard and train, performance manage folks, how we build products, serve our customers. It's all rooted in those same values. So it definitely helps, but it's not easy.
Yeah. No, it's a constant pursuit. So it's awesome that you guys continue to...
You have to be relentless. I mean, that's what we say. It's just culture in general just takes relentless kind of vigilance. And what's great is it's not just me. It's on everybody. The entire company, every employee from day one. And that's a really empowering thing, I think, for employees to know that they are arbiters. They're defenders of that culture. And we're going to do everything we can to defend it. It's what drives our success.
So you talked about your mission earlier, which is to build trust across the cloud. You know, in service of that mission, you've built, multiple products, the first being compliance automation, and then kind of extended, far beyond that. How have you prioritized which products and features to build first as you've expanded to tackle that vision?
Yeah, I need to start every response with far from perfect. I think one of the things, again, past life and current life, we sold to almost 500 universities in our prior company, but that was over a 6-7 year period. With Drata, one of the amazing things is within the first couple of months, we had hundreds of customers. Yeah. And there was obvious benefits that come with that, but the most valuable piece was the feedback that we were getting.
Yep.
We had a roadmap, we knew where we wanted to go and what we wanted to build, but it was immediately just sharpened with hundreds of pieces of feedback every week from our customers. And so one thing, again, that we did that wasn't perfect, but I will pat ourselves on the back a little bit, was just how we operationalized that. We've gotten it to a point now, again, with 5,500 plus customers, where you can imagine the amount of feedback that we're getting, and we have to prioritize what we build next. And we got it to a point now where we know, like, feature by feature on our roadmap, how many customers, how much revenue, how much potential customers and revenue is tied to each one. And then we definitely know, from down to a story point level, how much it costs us to build it. So you can imagine like an ROI on every one of these features on a roadmap, and use that to help prioritize what comes next. And then there's always just like the gut instinctual kind of overlay on that, where we can move things around. And it's funny, we did a executive leadership team offsite recently, and we did an assessment, it's called working genius. I don't know if anybody's heard of that, but you get your results, and there's six different types of working genius, and one of them is discernment. And we have an amazing product leader, and it was really confirming when we got the results. On that category, our product leader was on one complete extreme end of the spectrum, very data-driven. So every decision in their life is based off data.
Okay.
My results came back completely opposite end of the spectrum, just... It was like intuition, like kind of gut discernment. And all we did was look at each other and kind of nod, because we already knew, but when you see the data in front of you, it just makes it pretty real. And it was just this kind of acknowledgement of, this is a great 1-2 punch, a good balancing act, because our powers combined, you get to lead the product strategy the right way.
Yeah, completely agree. You need kind of that team composition to make it work.
Yeah, you got to go with got to lean into your gut instincts. Something I learned in a prior life.
So, you guys are, you started kind of working with younger companies that were just getting started. You're increasingly being pulled up market, working with, some of the largest enterprises, Fortune 50 enterprises in the world, who have, very complex and evolving compliance needs. How have you really managed, balancing servicing those customers, but also working with, the core early stage ecosystem and making sure that you still provide a great service to them?
Yeah, I mean, like, the short answer is one feeds the other, which is, it was kind of nice in our space. There's just like the typical SaaS company moving up market, or expanding, I should say, up market, that you have to have table stakes requirements. Fortunately for us, being drinking our own champagne, being first customer, it's like the security and compliance piece is pretty down pat. But there's the obvious kind of configurability complexity that comes with a mature enterprise company. Again, fortunately for us, we've been kind of pulled up market rather than just pushing our way, which we appreciate. Again, our startup customers were coming to us to stand up their security compliance posture so they could sell to the enterprise. Those enterprise companies were then able to see firsthand, through this trust center security assurance offering that we have, just how secure and compliant these vendors of theirs were. And they then came to us and said, this is pretty nice, saving us a lot of time in reviewing these vendors on a continuous basis. We'd love to do this for hundreds more vendors that we have. And so the nice kind of virtuous cycle starts to happen there, and it pulled us up market into those conversations earlier than we expected. This is, again, that vision of being the trust layer between our customers and those they do business with, that's it in reality. So yeah. Our customers and those they do business with, the ones they do business with are the enterprise companies out there. And so that's just been a really, really nice way for us to execute on the vision just about 10 times faster than we thought it was going to happen.
No, it makes a lot of sense. When you think about, what is the right time for customers to reach out to you on the early end of the spectrum? I'm sure founders that see compliance hurdles and sales cycles, they're highly attuned to the pain point. But what would you recommend in terms of, folks in the audience? When should they reach out?
There's an obvious statement, the earlier a company does it, stands up their security and compliance posture, the faster it is, the cheaper it is, the easier it is to maintain as they grow. That's just a fact. But I also empathize 100% with startups, one being one still ourselves, but even in a prior life, when you are building the plane while flying it, you have competing priorities left and right, and then you have these kind of existential priorities that just overshadow and trump all the others. I would have been guilty 10 years ago of the last company saying something like, am I really going to prioritize security and compliance right now when I'm still trying to find product market fit? If I can't find product market fit in the next 18 months, it won't matter if we're security and compliance. We won't have a company. And so all of a sudden, all the attention goes there. And then the irony is you kind of start to unlock product market fit, and then you're slammed with this paywall of security and compliance. And so I always say companies, especially startups, you're building the plane while flying it. You are accumulating debt, all kinds of debt. There's tech debt, which everyone in tech kind of immediately thinks of. Sure, absolutely. There's also kind of operational debt. There's cultural debt. There's security and compliance debt. We felt the pain of security and compliance debt in our prior life. That's why we dedicated ourselves and our entire company to solving that. So at least we could help companies pay down that debt if it is accumulating on their path to product market fit. And then, of course, for the companies that are starting basically on day one by doing it with us, it's again, faster, cheaper, easier to maintain as they grow.
And trust management, it's clearly a global problem. We're sitting here in Helsinki. You guys have started building out your presence in EMEA a year plus ago. I think I read your head of Europe posted recently that you had an insane Q3, so congrats on that. It seems like things continue to go well here. But what, there are a lot of European founders and startups in the room. Maybe talk a little bit about what you have planned for Europe and your growth here.
Yeah. About a year and a half ago, we stood up a team based in London, servicing all of Europe, all of EMEA. They've done an amazing job. We kind of organically already had a good number of customers. About 25-30% of our customers were outside the U.S., just with growing regulation globally, of course. And they had an amazing quarter. They've grown 100% year over year, and we're going to continue to expand. It's we joke with a lot of the folks at ICONIQ around the fact that in our first two and a half years, we went multi-product, like multi-SKU, multi-segment, startups all the way to enterprise, and multinational. It's did it all at the same time. And I always catch myself, hindsight 2020, would I do it again? And I would do the exact same thing, even though it's madness. The opportunity demands it, and then we're gonna go capitalize on the opportunity. But amazing job, an amazing team and culture that they've built there as well.
We've avoided talking about AI for most of this talk.
I thought we were going to do it.
It is the flavor of the week. And, with the growing influence of AI and cybersecurity, we'd love your thoughts on how it's impacting, the compliance world and trust with companies.
Yeah, we said trust way more than we said AI, which is...
We'll catch up.
Yeah. Here we go. No, I could be short here. My mind goes to two places when it comes to AI, specific to the trust management space. One, for the last 18 months, we've been incorporating AI like so many companies out there to help save our customers time and money. We could do even deeper automation than we're already doing by layering that in. We could save our customers a lot of time during that security review process, taking structured, unstructured data, applying AI in the product to just answer security questionnaires much faster, review questionnaires that are being sent, review the SOC 2 reports, the ISO certs. All of that.
Yeah.
That's kind of table stakes. And then there's the other side of it, which is making sure our customers are using AI in a secure and compliant way. The worst thing would be for it to backfire and for you to lose trust with your customers because of the not having the proper security or privacy controls in place with your use of AI. And so we help our customers comply now with AI-specific frameworks, regulation that's coming out, like ISO 42001, NIST's AI risk management framework, and there's plenty more on the way, as you could imagine. And so it's kind of twofold for us in the trust management space with AI. So
you're seeing the demand pick up in terms of what your customers are expected to comply with.
Yeah, and it's shifting so much earlier. As we talk about startups, again, the day you launch, the expectation has become that you're going to be doing things the right way. And so it's great to be able to support our startup customers.
One of the other Drata rules that you alluded to is Drata speed, which I think is also a fascinating concept. And you've obviously moved incredibly fast in terms of what you've been able to achieve. Can you tell us a little bit more about that and, again, how you've maintained this trust with your customers as you've moved that quickly?
Yeah, it almost became a meme, so we had to be a little careful. We say we age in Drata years instead of dog years because everything just goes, back, since we launched, 10 times faster than we thought it would go. And that's, like I said earlier, that makes it a pretty uncomfortable place to work every day for most people, and why we have to be so vigilant and so deliberate with how we recruit talent and how we convey what it's like to work at the company. But it doesn't mean that we do a million things all at once and we don't know how to prioritize. In fact, it's the opposite. Drata speed, at least the way we like to think about it and actually action it, is we prioritize really, really well. And then the things we prioritize, we do better and faster than anyone. And we want to take pride in that and continue to drive that home.
That's awesome. It's certainly one of the things that we also value at ICONIQ. So we like to move quickly. You mentioned you're a second time founder. You've shared a lot of your learnings and things that you're implementing now at Drata that you hadn't implemented in your previous startup. What are some of the other lessons that you've taken with you on this journey that have helped you build Drata into the success that it is?
A lot. We've learned so much, especially in our prior company. I mean, being a second-time founder is amazing in a lot of ways, but I think even more so, being a second-time founder with the same co-founders and the same early team, same early engineers, it was like a cheat code for us. We got to triangulate on all of the lessons that we all cumulatively learned. Way too many to list in the next 2 minutes. But maybe one, I touched a little bit on kind of like that debt profile that every company has, whether it's security compliance debt, tech debt. I try to encourage other founders to just be as deliberate as you can, even though you're building a plane while flying it, about what that debt profile looks like, so you don't get kind of bit in the behind like we did in our prior company, our prior life. Another thing that I think about often, and I was at an event recently where something was said that just helped resonate quite a bit. As a first-time founder, I was there's just so much humility. I didn't know anything about anything, learning everything the first time, kind of the hardest way possible. And so I would seek advice constantly from other founders for any kind of decision that I was making. And the problems with advice is I would get conflicting advice and then I'd be paralyzed with indecision. I'd look to my employees and they would look to me and I assumed that they expected me to have all the answers to everything with just guaranteed certainty, which would just further paralyze the indecision. I learned, and what I heard at that conference was someone said, clarity over certainty.
Yep.
It cut through and it really resonated because that's exactly what I was looking for in those words. Just three simple words of, employees shouldn't expect certainty. And most of the time, if you ask them, they don't. But they do want and they should get from us as leaders is clarity. We're going to be very clear about what we're trying to do, what we think the plan is to go do that. And then we'll reserve the right to be wrong. We're probably going to be wrong.
Yeah.
And we're going to have the humility to learn and iterate and be very clear as we're doing that. So there should be no certainty, but there should absolutely be clarity. And I think that's something that, it just hits me more and more every day.
Yeah. That's fantastic. So we have one more minute. I think you're on stage with one of your primary capital partners. A lot of founders out there are thinking about raising money. Building trust with your investment partner is a big decision. How have you done that in, both of your startups?
Yeah, with Drata, we had just the perspective to appreciate the whole opportunity, everything that we were doing, and that's just fueled the execution and the further appreciation. One of the things we appreciate is just the the opportunity to be picky about who we brought to the table. And being so deliberate about the culture of the company, making sure that we brought on investors that matched or helped kind of fuel that culture. You know, we're a trust being the most important thing, but we're also a very competitive bunch. We wanted to make sure we aligned with folks that were going to kind of match that intensity. And I think we've done a really good job of that so far, and ICONIQ's a perfect example.
Great. That was the soundbite we were looking for, so thank you.
Nailed it.
We're out of time, but thank you for being here.
Oh,
this was fantastic.
You.
Hope everyone learned a lot. Thank you all for joining us. Enjoy the rest of the conference. Thank you.
Thank you all.